Hey guys, I'm Tom the Tech Chap, and this is the new 2020 MacBook Air. So it looks and feels exactly the same as before, but Apple have made three big upgrades here. They fixed the keyboard. It now uses the much improved Magic Keyboard that we get in the MacBook Pro 16. They've added the latest Intel 10th gen processors, which are now quad-core on the i5 and i7 models. Plus, we get much faster Intel Iris Plus graphics. The results are pretty crazy actually, but I'll come back to that in a second. And they've doubled the base storage from 128 to 256 gigs. Other little upgrades include much faster RAM, Bluetooth 5, and it can now output to a 6K monitor at 60Hz, up from 5K before. And that's pretty much it, but you know what? These are exactly the upgrades the MacBook Air needed. And they've cut the price by 100. It now starts at £999, the same in dollars, with double the storage from before. The caveat though is last year's entry-level model for 1100 came with an i5 processor, and you'll need to pay 100 more to get it with the i5. But overall, we are getting more for our money here. And actually, if you are a student or a teacher, you can get 100 off the price with Apple's education discount. So it is good to have a more affordable option. My biggest problem though, and actually not with the Air itself, but the fact that Apple haven't yet updated their MacBook Pro 13. While the Air is capable enough for most tasks, it uses Intel's lowest power Y series of chips. Although the upside is this is completely silent, we don't have any external fans, and of course we get this beautiful thin and light chassis. But if you do want something with a little bit more oomph for more intensive tasks, you either have to buy a current MacBook Pro 13 with a slightly iffy keyboard and last year's specs, or pay upwards of $2,400 for a massive MacBook Pro 16. Anyway, back to the Air, and this is the third model since the big design refresh back in 2018, and it's the cheapest Apple laptop you can buy. Now, side by side with the latest 2020 Dell XPS 13, the Air is starting to show its age a little bit with those slightly chunky bezels. Although the cheapest new XPS 13 is still 40% more expensive than this, so that is worth bearing in mind. I do still think the Air looks great though. Yes, I know it's the third year with the same design, but the 13.3-inch display is sharp and color accurate, and I think the resolution is a good middle ground between Full HD and the battery draining 4K. The all aluminium body, which comes in silver, space gray, all this very fancy gold color I have here feels well made. It weighs just 1.29 kilograms, and it's also the little things like a sturdy hinge that can be opened with one finger, a fast and reliable Touch ID reader, the slickness of macOS Catalina, and of course that huge trackpad and the fantastic keyboard. It took them long enough, but this is now one of my favorite keyboards on any laptop. It's quieter and feels more responsive thanks to the new, well, updated scissor mechanism. It's just lovely to type on. So altogether, it's just a great all-round laptop, and it's not ridiculously end-of-the-world expensive either. There's really not much to complain about here. Well, I say that, but there's always something that can be better. I mean, as before, we still only get two USB-C Thunderbolt 3 ports and a headphone jack. It is what it is, but you'll need an adapter for most accessories or SD cards. There's also no Wi-Fi 6, unfortunately, which isn't the end of the world, but it would have made it a bit more future-proof. Alright, so I'm recording this with the 720p webcam up top, and it's okay. I've actually got some pretty good lighting on me right now, so it would only get worse in the dark. Actually, if I pick this up with me and I move into a darker area, you can see how noisy and grainy and kind of ugly that is. It's a shame that Apple have kind of forgotten about the webcam again. The three studio mics sound pretty good. Hopefully the audio quality is decent, but it would have been nice if they'd upgraded the webcam here as well. But actually it is the same as the much more expensive MacBook Pro 16. Here's one I made earlier. So I actually have the cheapest model here with the i3, 8GB of RAM, and 256GB of storage. Except for the odd little hiccup sometimes when I've just loaded a program or got loads of tabs open, I've had an almost flawless experience with this basic one. Working, watching Netflix, Lightroom, playing the odd Apple Arcade game, even a bit of light 1080p video editing in Final Cut. It does everything you'd expect a MacBook Air to do. Now, to get an idea of how much faster this one is, I wanted to test it versus last year's model, the equivalent entry level. Although, unfortunately, I didn't actually have one to hand, but that's where my good friend, Michael Josh from Gadget Match, swooped in and saved the day because he actually shared his results with me from the i5 8GB model of the 2019 MacBook Air, which is the equivalent entry level spec. So it turns out the new model is 28% faster in single core and 26% faster in multi-core performance. That's a big jump, but it's in the graphics department we see the biggest boost. Geekbench's OpenCL test saw a 61% increase, and the Metal benchmark jumped 183% over last year's model. We actually ran these tests a bunch of times just to confirm the numbers, because this really is a big upgrade. But as impressive as this base model is, if I were you, I would pay an extra $100 and spec it with an i5 processor. It's quad-core rather than dual-core on the i3, which will make a pretty big difference to performance, and we get even faster graphics. The i3's Iris Plus chip has 48 execution units, which is still double last year, but the i5 and i7 models have 64. So yeah, I go with the i5. Although, if you are Mr. Moneybags, you can spec it all the way up to an i7, 16 gigs of RAM, and a whopping 2 terabytes of SSD storage. And actually, even with the speed boost, we're still getting the same battery life as last year. Going through my general use tests of web browsing, Netflix, YouTube, Spotify, normal everyday stuff, I got 8.5 hours of use out of the MacBook Air. And actually, with the 30-watt charger, it tops up to 80% in about an hour. So it's not super fast charging, but it's good enough. Now, unlike the refreshed MacBook Pro 16, the new Air gets a dual rather than quad speaker setup.
Why would I betray you?
We all have our secrets.
Why would I betray you?
We all have our secrets. You just didn't get to yours yet.
So, the big question, should you buy the new 2020 MacBook Air? Well, there's a reason why the MBA is pretty much the most popular 13-inch laptop on the market. It's not perfect. As I say, it would have been nice if they'd upgraded the webcam. We still have fairly limited port selection, and considering we were getting Y-series processors in this, and it still costs £1,000, it's not the best value laptop in the world. But with the performance gains we've seen here, along with the new Magic Keyboard, double the storage, and a few other little tweaks, this is absolutely one of the best laptops you can buy. I highly recommend it. I think Microsoft's Surface Laptop 3 is probably the closest Windows competitor. It's a great laptop with a slightly more powerful U-series chip. Although, to get at least 256 gigs of storage and the more premium aluminium chassis, it does start to get very expensive. But for most of you, I think half the reason you want the MacBook Air is for macOS. So I think until we see an updated MacBook Pro 13, or maybe a MacBook Pro 14 actually, as we saw with the 15 to the 16, unless you're doing 4K video editing or 3D rendering, this is the Apple laptop to go for. But what do you think? Would you buy one, and would you pay the £100 extra to get this with the i5? Let me know in the comments below. And if you're not already sick of seeing my face, then why not hit that subscribe button below? Thank you so much for watching, guys, and I'll catch you next time right here on the Tech Chat.